Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Wednesday Night Bible Study. It's so good to see you. What a day this has been. Have you ever had one of those days where pretty much nothing happened like it was supposed to? Well, this has been one of them. But praise God, it is a good day. Everything is good. What could have been a really bad thing, it's not too, as bad as we thought, so praise God for that. Wow. It has been an interesting day, particularly a very interesting afternoon, to say the least. But God is faithful, and he watches over us, and he protects us with his right hand, and praise God for that. So welcome in, whether you're watching by live or by replay. I want to thank you for hanging out with me tonight as we study the book of Judges together. Tonight, we're going to continue our survey of the Old Testament, or the survey of the Bible. And tonight we have made our way into the book of Judges. And for those of you who want a more in-depth study of the book of Judges, you can go back on our YouTube channel and look for that particular study where I did a verse-by-verse breakdown of the entire book of Judges. So that was that is a much deeper study than what we're going to be doing tonight, because our goal during the survey Bible studies is to just hit all the main points and to look at the themes of the books, how the books apply to a historical context, and how they apply to us as believers today, particularly those in the Old Testament, which so many times are viewed as being not necessary in many ways, or aspects of it. You know, we don't need to worry about as New Testament Christians, but this survey shows us that the whole counsel of God from Genesis to Revelation, or as one preacher used to say, Genesis to the maps, is very, very relevant to our world, very relevant to our life as believers. So, and Judges is definitely no exception to that rule. Okay. So we have been having a great time going through this study together. We'll be kind of picking up a little bit of speed because we're going to be getting into 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. Those we're going to be doing together. So instead of doing like 1st and 2nd Samuel, we'll do 1st and 2nd together. So we're going to be kind of picking up some traction, and we're going to move quickly into the Old Testament prophets, which we will look at, of course, individually. Some of them, depending on their length, we may look at two or three at a time, because our goal is to get through the Bible in a year. And we started this back in October. So we're hoping that October of 2022, which will be here before we know it, that by October 2022, we will have gone through the entire Bible together. So that's our goal. Hopefully we'll make it, or, you know, at least maybe by this time next year, we will have made it through the whole Bible. But again, thank you for hanging out with me. Let's go ahead and open with the Lord in prayer, and we'll get started. Father God, we just want to thank you so much for your many blessings. And Lord, we just want to thank you for your faithfulness. Lord, we thank you for your watch care over us. Lord, your word tells us that you know our comings and our goings. And Father, I just thank you that your hand has been upon us. I thank you, God, that your hand has been upon our church family. Father, even as right now, there are men and women ministering in your name, Father God. And I just praise you for them. And I pray, God, that you would allow a great resolution to the need that is we're encountering at the moment. And Father God, we just know that you watch after your people. And Father God, we just entrust our church, our community, our state, and our nation into your hands. And Father God, we just pray that your will would be done as we try to live in accordance with your will and your calling upon our life. Be with us tonight, Lord, as we rightly divide your word. Father, be with us as we meet together in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, go ahead. Oh, boy, I'll tell you what, this cloudy weather stuff makes my allergies go crazy. It's terrible. It's like, oh, my lands. So if my eyes pop out, my goodness, if the storm, there's a storm coming in, and it must have some pressure behind it, because the longer my head's fucking a vice grip. Oh, my mercy. Anyway, so if my eyes pop out, you know, we'll just... All right. Laying all jokes aside, we better get serious. We're not, you know, can have fun, right? All right. Turn to the book of Judges in your Bible. Once again, I hope that you take opportunity to write in your Bible. As you see, okay, there it goes. But I write some things. I underline things. There's actually even a New Testament reference there from 1 Corinthians that I made a note of there. And that's what I like to do when I'm studying my Bible. If I'm at a conference, or if I'm, you know, at a hearing a message somewhere, if I hear something on the radio or whatever, I jot notes down. If I'm reading something, there's all kinds of things. So I can't encourage you enough to do that, but to write in your Bible so that you can go back later and read some very unique aspects of the Word of God and some things that maybe. I know a lot of people like to almost use their Bible for a journal. Matter of fact, I'm really seriously thinking about 5 years ago, I was going to do that and didn't. And, you know, kind of got lost in it with it. It's like, I don't know. I'm really thinking, I'm praying strong about it to maybe do that this year, is to journal through a Bible this year. You get, you know, a mentor of mine used to get a Bible at the beginning of every year as they did their devotion through the year. They would make notes in the Bible. They would make, you know, thoughts that they had or prayers that they had. And then at the end of the year, as a Christmas present, they would give that Bible to a loved one. So different loved ones in their family got a copy of that Bible. Since then, they've gone home to be with the Lord. So what a cherished possession that is, that somebody would have that Bible. So, you know, just kind of something as part of leaving a legacy as a Christian that we should be doing. We should be thinking, especially at, you know, not just when we get older, but in our life, we need to be thinking about the legacy that we want to leave behind for our family and for our children. And a great way to do that is to leave the legacy of God's word. So just something to kind of think about, you know, as we're moving along. And a survey study like this would be a great time to be able to, you know, each week, we're kind of being led together to do it, to go through each book, make a few notes. You know, it doesn't have to be, you know, all kinds of theology and stuff like that, but just some notes and things. And at the end of it, you know, say, hey, you know, I want to give this to someone. So in the book of Genesis, in the book of Judges, the book was written by Samuel. Although it does not specifically name the author, tradition has it that the prophet Samuel was the author of the book of Judges. And there are actually evidences within the book that gives credibility to that argument. It indicates that the author of Judges lived shortly after the period of time of the Judges. So that would be very fitting with the prophet Samuel. We see just kind of the language of it would be very fitting of a perspective like Samuel. And once we look at 1 and 2 Samuel, we look at those, you kind of see how those things tie together. So pretty much without a lot of debate and a lot of controversy, most people believe that the book of Judges was written by the prophet Samuel. Now, the book of Judges was written likely between the time of 1045 and 1000 BC. So this would be 1045 to 1000 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. Now, one of the things that I've liked to do as we've been going through this, I'm trying to do it in each book, is kind of what is happening around the world. And interestingly enough, a lot was happening during this period of time. And I found some really neat information on not only what was happening in other cultures in the world during this time, but also I found a really neat website about some of the inventions during these particular time periods. So I want to share a little bit of that with you tonight. So what was happening around the world? Well, around this time, of course, is the Hebrew occupation of Canaan, which we know that they have moved into the promised land in the book of Joshua. So this time frame covers that historically. In India, about this time, they have developed what is called the Vedas. And those were the Hindu scriptures. And they were written in early Sanskrit. And they contain hymns, philosophy, and guidance in ritual for the priests of the Vedic religion. So if you've ever studied world history, this would come up, is that the Vedas in India were written between 1200 and 800 BC. Also, between 1100 BC and 250 BC was the Zhao, or the, some people call it the Chao dynasty in China. From 1100 to 771 was the Western Chao dynasty in China. And then 1025 to 933 BC was the unified Hebrew monarchy of Saul, David, and Solomon, which we will be looking at as we're going through these books right now. And then roughly around 1000 BC was the rise of the caste system in India as well. So a lot was happening in India, really. So in another, you know, farther east there, things are really happening during this time as well. So let's look at a little some specific dates. In 1184 BC, Troy was captured. That's important because the Greeks united under the command of Agamemnon to attack Troy on Asia Minor. And the Trojans were besieged for a lengthy period before submitting to the Greeks. That was a very big battle between a war between Troy and the Greeks. In 1140 BC, so we're a little back from our timeline, but I wanted to kind of give you a little bit of this so it gives us a broader picture. Some of these things have happened just prior to what we are reading, but you know we're clicking down because remember BC, we're counting down, okay? So 1140 BC, the Second Babylonian Empire started after an extended period of domination by the Kassites. A native dynasty arose in Babylon. Heading the new dynasty was Nebuchadnezzar, not related to Nebuchadnezzar who conquered Jerusalem, however. So that's kind of interesting. This was further back. We're going to see that particular invasion happen in the near future. In 1100 BC, the Hallstatt culture iron was first used for the first time in Austria. From Austria, the use of iron spread throughout Europe. Now, we saw the use of iron here as we begin looking at the part of in Canaan last week. We also see it now spreading into Europe. And the first part of the Iron Age in Europe was known as the Hallstatt period. So iron is making a huge difference across the world. Just like bronze made a difference, iron is making even a bigger difference. In 1027 BC, the Shang dynasty or the vassal tribe of Zhao defeats the Shang dynasty. So we said earlier that the Zhao dynasty came to rule in China. And the tribe of Zhao, under the leadership of Wu Wang, defeated the Shang dynasty in 1027 BC. And they established the Zhao dynasty, which became the longest lasting dynasty in Chinese history. In sixth grade, Rebecca had to take world history, and they spent an enormous amount of time on Chinese history. And the Chows there was the longest lasting dynasty of the in Chinese history. The Chow continued the central administration of the Shang, and they included individual principalities called Gao, or the Chinese word for states. So the Shang dynasty was defeated, and the tribe of Chow, under the leadership of Wu Wang, became dominant in Chinese history in 1027. In 1090 BC, the Nubia became independent. With the breakup of the new kingdom, Nubia once again became independent of Egypt. And Nubia, otherwise known as the Kingdom of Kush, became a major trading point. So in 1090, which is basically within our time frame here in the book of Judges, even though Israel, of course, is not in Egypt anymore, Egypt was still happening. Egypt has gone through a developmental period. A new kingdom has come in. And then even in 1090, the new kingdom actually dissolves, which became the end of the new kingdom, coincided with the end of the dynasty of the Ramessids or the Ramses. As we know, Ramses the First, Ramses the Great, the dynasty of the Ramessids. So Egypt entered then a long period of turmoil and foreign conflict, which would just end up being the death eventually of the Egyptian empire altogether. In 1070 BC, there was the collapse of Assyria. This is the same Assyria that we see in the Bible. So the book of Judges was written somewhere between 1050, 1045, and 1000 BC. The collapse of the Assyrian was just before this in 1070 BC. And the Assyrian Empire collapsed under the assault of the Arameans and the Babylonians. And the Assyrian Empire reasserted itself under the reign of Assurdin II. So you will see that as the fall of the Assyrians, then it gives birth to the Babylonians, which will then give birth to the Medes and the Persians, which will give birth to the Greeks and the Romans. So all of that continues to move through history. So we will be following that very clear movement of history as we go through the Bible together. And then in 1010 BC, King Saul would become the first king of the Israelites. He would later, of course, be killed by the Philistines at the Battle of Mount Gilboa, and he would be succeeded by King David. And we will see that as we move from the book of Judges into Ruth. We'll move into 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles. We'll see that transition. Because in the book of Judges, it's very important, because what we see is Israel wants a king. Israel is becoming dissatisfied with God being in charge of everything. They want a king. They feel that a king would help them better, I guess. And so God does not send them a king. God sends them judges, and hence the book of Judges. And these judges will rule over Israel and bring order, if you will, to the tribes. But again, even during this period of time, Israel still longs for a king. And eventually, God does send them a king. And that happens in 1010 BC with King Saul. And that really becomes a lesson in be careful what you wish for. Because Saul, we will look at that, but Saul was not a good king. He really was a king that God sent Israel to bring a form of judgment upon Israel. And God will do that. God will allow leaders to come in charge over nations in order to bring judgment upon that nation. So one of the fun things, though, kind of looking at history, of course, is always fun. But what are some of the inventions during this period of time? This I found really cool. In 1050 BC, which would be the first end of when this writing happened, artillery was invented in China. Bombs were fired from catapults. And it's interesting that those bombs kind of came as a result of the fireworks. Because remember, the Chinese invented fireworks. And so those bombs, they were like, you know, you can blow things up with these. They just made artillery out of it. 1041 movable type was also invented in China from clay bricks by Pi Sheng. So movable type. 1025 BC, sugar extraction happened in Arabia and from sugar cane by the Seljuk Persians. So sugar became a huge deal. And I'll tell you, sugar will change the world. Sugar will, from that point, be traded and will become a very, you know, as we talk about coffee and we talk about tea, you remember the British Tea Party, even in our own country, you talk about sugar, all those items like that, what are called commodities, have been used for trading for hundreds and hundreds of years. So when sugar was extracted from sugarcane in 1025, the world really began to change in many ways. Sugar really changed the world. 1020 BC, the parabolic mirror was also invented in Arabia from polished silver and iron by Ibn al-Haytham. And we actually saw one of the first mirrors in the book of Exodus when God had them hammer out the brass plate for the laver, and they would see the reflection in that. But this was a more developed mirror. Then in 1000 BC, toothpaste was invented in China from soap bean powder. I think that's kind of interesting, the first toothpaste. And also for you guys, ladies and gentlemen out there who like to sew, in 1000 BC, the thimble was invented in Byzantium in Corinth or modern day Greece. So it was in Greece where the thimble was invented. Also in 1000 BC, the portable flamethrower, once again, invented in China. Okay. So artillery, fireworks, portable flamethrowers, we kind of get the theme, right? Also, listen to this, and we're going to have this for supper tonight. In 1000 BC, pizza was invented in Byzantium, in modern day Turkey. It spread west to Italy and east as lama. So guess what? Pizza was invented in Turkey, not Italy. Isn't that interesting? Also, in 1000 BC, in the modern sundial, as we know it, was invented in Moorish Spain using a shadow marker parallel to the Earth's axis. The longbow was invented in Wales. The kayak and parka were invented in the polar regions of the world by the Inuit people. Grenades were invented in Byzantium. They were filled with petrol and gasoline. Gold leaf thread was invented in the Mediterranean, all of this in 1000 BC. Gold leaf thread in the Mediterranean in Cyprus. Clothes of iron were developed in Europe and used by the Vikings in 1000 BC. The Czech was invented in Arabia in modern-day Iraq. Cauterization was invented also in Moorish Spain. Interesting that we have Moorish Spain invented the sundial, but also invented the cauterization process. That's, of course, a searing of tissue used in surgery. Bars of soft soap. So toothpaste was invented in 1000 BC. Also, soap was invented. Toothpaste was invented in China, but soap was invented in Arabia, and it was made from olive oil and wood ash. Find that fascinating. And then also in 1000 BC, the ambulance. The very first ambulance was invented in the Middle East. It was horse-drawn in Palestine by the Crusaders. It was then reinvented by Dominique Jean Larry in France in 1792. But 792 years earlier, it was invented by the ambulance. The ambulance was invented by the by the Crusaders. So fascinating history, fascinating stuff. So I find that all really cool. All right, let's look at an outline for just a minute. This is a three-part outline that I had put together when we were studying the book of Judges, going by verse by verse. And so this is the outline. I put it down here at the bottom of chapter one. I would encourage you, to write this outline somewhere, maybe on the part of your Bible where it says Judges. You can put this little outline. But the first part is chapter one, verse one, through chapter three, verse six, are the roots of unfaithfulness. The roots of unfaithfulness. The second part is found from Judges chapter 3, verse 7 to chapter 16, verse 31. Okay, so that's the entirety of chapter 16. And that is the downward spiral of unfaithfulness. So the first part is the roots of unfaithfulness. Then the second part is the downward spiral of unfaithfulness. And the third part runs from Judges chapter 17, verse 1 to chapter 21, verse 25. And that is the depths of unfaithfulness. So we have the roots of unfaithfulness to the downward spiral of unfaithfulness, then to the depths of unfaithfulness. So that's a really good outline because really, what we're looking at in the book of Judges is really the unfaithfulness of Israel against God. They demand, we read this about Israel, and it's really kind of sobering. We think, my goodness, here they had God in charge. Why would they doubt that? But, we as people have a real problem with faith. We have a real problem with it. And even though God had done more than enough to demonstrate that they really didn't need a whole lot of, faith in some respects, because he manifests himself in such powerful, miraculous ways, but they still wanted human help. There was that humanism. There was that humanistic side of us that wants help. So they wanted a king. And everybody else had kings. All the other kingdoms had kings. If they were going to be a people group, they needed a king, and they were just stuck on that altogether. And that just grew more and more into this unfaithfulness until God brought in the judges. So what was the purpose of the book of Judges? Well, first of all, it's divided into two sections, as we looked at an outline. But the first section, chapters 1 through 16, gives an account of the wars of deliverance between beginning with the Israelites' defeat of the Canaanites and then ending with the defeat of the Philistines and the death of Samson. Okay, so the first 16 verses of the book of Judges are the wars of deliverance between the Israelites. They defeat the Canaanites, ending with the defeat of the Palestinians. And then chapter 17 through 21 looks at really serves as an appendix. And I even talked about this in our verse by verse study, is that it's more of an appendix and does not really relate to the previous chapters. But things are noted in there that was when there was no king in Israel. So the book of Ruth, as a matter of fact, was originally part of the book of Judges, but not in AD 450. It was removed to become a book on its own. So that really, it makes sense that Judges moves into the book of Ruth because of the historical context. So you're really looking at those first 16 chapters as the meat and potatoes of what was going on. And then there's all kinds of additional information. Let me flip there here real quick. When you get into like chapter 17, you get into this Micah's idolatry. The Danites adopt Micah's idolatry. You've got the Levites' concubines. There's the Israel's war with the Benjamites. There's Gibeah's crime. There's, you know, wives provided for the Benjamites. There's a whole lot of historical information that happens there that seems a little apart from the real purpose of the book of Judges, but it gives us some really good historical information then as we move further and further into the Old Testament. Now, what are some of the key verses? One of the key verses, this is a big one. It's in Judges chapter 2, verses 16 through 19. There are three of them that are jotted down here. One is, it says, this is Judges chapter 2, verses 16 through 19. It says, then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of these raiders, yet they would not listen to their judges, but prostituted themselves to other gods and worshiped them. Unlike their fathers, they quickly turned away from the way in which their fathers had walked and the way of obedience to the Lord's commands. Whenever the Lord raised up a judge for them, he was with the judge and saved them out of the hands of their enemies as long as the judge lived. For the Lord had compassion on them as they groaned under those who oppressed and afflicted them. But when the judge died, the people returned to the ways even more corrupt than those of their fathers, following other gods and serving and worshiping them. They refused to give up their evil practices and stubborn ways. So that was the root of faithfulness that, as we said, continues this downward spiral. Judges chapter 10, verse 15 says, but the Israelites said to the Lord, we have sinned, do with us whatever you think best, but please rescue us now. Interesting statement. Wow. Judges 21, 25 says, in those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as he saw fit. Very common theme in Judges, very common theme before God brings a king into their midst. Is they just did everything as they saw fit in their eyes, which is where we are in our culture today. People do everything as they see fit in their own eyes. So let's look at a brief summary of the book together. The book of Judges is really a tragic account of how Yahweh God was taken for granted by the children of Israel, by his children, year after year, century after century. It is really a sad book. It really is. God brings a means by which Israel could be delivered by these judges, and they still refused to believe. They still refused to trust. They would still fall into the arms, if you will, of pagan idols. They fell into idolatry and absolute humanism and any other religion they could come up with. And it's really a sad contrast. One writer said it's really a sad contrast to the book of Joshua, which chronicles the blessings God bestowed on the Israelites for their obedience in conquering the land. Because we get to Judges, and they're disobedient and they're idolatrous. And what happens is it leads to many defeats for Israel that they would not have had to suffer had they just stayed faithful to God. And there's information for us there, is that when we rebel against God, we wonder why we lose our grip, right? We wonder why we start feeling defeated and have defeats in our life when we stop being dependent upon God. Well, there it is. Matter of fact, I had made a note in Judges chapter 2, verse 10, that it really was a generation of ignorance. And you know, we're there now. We live in a biblically illiterate society now. We live in a generation of ignorance. We live in a generation of spiritual ignorance right now. And we know that God will only put up with that so long. But God never failed Israel. He never failed to show his love to them. Whenever they would repent from their ways, they would call upon his name. He would forgive them. And he was there all the time. So through those first 15 chapters of Judges, we see God's unfailing love, but we see his unfailing faithfulness to keep the promise that he had made to Abraham to protect and bless his offspring. That went all the way back to Genesis chapter 12. So hundreds of years earlier, God was honoring that promise that he made to Abraham. So God brought 12 judges upon Israel, and they were Othniel, Ehud, Shamgar, Deborah, Gideon, Tola, Jair, Japheth, There was a, for 25, I don't know why, echo, stop, echo, stop. Sometimes. Okay. And for a period of 25 years, there were three judges that were Ibzan, Elon, and Abdon. And then Samson was the last judge. So there were 12 judges. Very important because 12 in the Bible is the number of government. So it's interesting that just as there were 12 tribes, there are 12 judges. It's interesting, too, that we're talking about this past Sunday. In all likelihood, the Magi that came from the east to Bethlehem, there were probably 12 of them because they typically rode in groups of 12. 12 is a number of government. It is a number of representation. So there were 12 judges. There were 12 tribes. There were 12 Magi. There were 12 disciples. So after the death of Joshua and his contemporaries, the Israelites returned to serving Baal or Baal and Ashtaroth. They fell right back into it again. And so God allowed them to suffer the consequences of worshiping false gods. But then they would cry out to Yahweh for help. So God sends them judges to lead them in righteous living. So God says, okay, I'm going to send you. And he sends 12 judges. And these judges were from a period of 1397 to 1061 BC. Okay, so we're talking about 400 years here. There were these judges. God was showing them how to live a righteous life. Yet they 480 years. That, you know, when we look at this, you look at the historical span of the period of time that the book of Judges covers. It's a 480 year span from 1397 to 1061 BC. Now, as we said, the book was written between 1045 and 1000 BC, but it covers a time period of 1397 BC all the way to 1061 BC. But time after time, they continue to turn their back on God. One of the most notable judge was the 12th and final judge. That was Samson, who came to lead the Israelites after 40 years of captivity under the rule of the Philistines. Deborah was a female judge. There's fascinating study just on Deborah. But Samson definitely was the most notable. And Samson's reign as judge is recorded in 1 Samuel in chapters 4 through 7. One writer says one of the reasons God used Samson was that he had a nation to protect or save. He had a God to serve and he had a home to honor. And you read that in that outline there. So Samson led God's people to victory over the Philistines, where he lost his own life after serving as a judge in Israel for 20 years. So with Samson, back in Numbers chapter 6, we were introduced to this this concept of the Nazarite oath, where the person would not shave, they would not cut their hair, they would not drink wine or any fermented beverage. And we see that Samson was first to introduce us to that Nazarite oath, which we would see even later kept by even John the Baptist. One of the most infamous relationships in world history probably is found in chapter 16 with Samson and Delilah. And a long time ago, I was at a conference and a preacher made this statement. He was preaching about Samson and talking about the faithfulness of God. And one of the fascinating things about reading in Judges, the life of Samson, is that the term that the Bible will say, Samson went down. And one of the fascinating things, as this preacher said, was Samson always went down spiritually when he went down geographically. So it's like when he ever went down somewhere, he went down not only geographically, not only where he was physically, but he also went down spiritually. It's kind of interesting. So when we look at chapter 17 through 21, we see that what's called the appendix, but it really is the dynamics of a fallen nation. When you look at those 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, those five chapters, it is the dynamics of a fallen nation. And you see a nation in absolute spiritual turmoil. But repeatedly, judges will say, The book of Judges says that Israel did what seemed right in their own eyes. So that's what you get. So here we are in this book. Like I said, it's a very good book. This is one you want to read. If you have not read Judges yet, I want to encourage you to do that. There are also some foreshadowings. We look at these. What are some of the things that we see as it plays into things that are going to yet come into the New Testament? The announcement to Samson's mother that she would bear a son to lead Israel is like a foreshadowing of the announcement to Mary about the birth of Jesus as the Messiah, right? We also see that God sent his angel to both women and told them that they would conceive and bear a son. We see it told in Judges 13:7 about Samson. We see it told in Luke 1:31 about Jesus. And each of them would lead God's people. Interesting foreshadowings there. And it would also just foreshadow God's compassionate delivery of his people. Despite their sin, despite the rejection of him, that all points a picture and presents a picture of Christ on the cross. That, you know, when man was at his absolute worst, God was at his absolute best. Jesus died to save his people, all who would ever believe in him from their sin. So although most of those who have followed Jesus during his ministry would fall away or reject him, he still remained faithful to his promise and went to the cross to die for us. And, you know, no matter how long in our life we reject him, he is always willing to save us when we call upon his name. So what are some of the practical applications of this book? Well, first of all, disobedience always brings judgment, always has, always will. And that is very indicated here in the book of Judges. And the Israelites present a perfect example of what we are not to do. Instead of learning from experience that God will always punish rebellion against them, they continue to disobey and they suffer God's displeasure and they suffer God's discipline. So we learn a great example of what we are not to do. So Judges is good for that too. Also, if we continue in our disobedience, we are just inviting God's discipline on our life. The Bible says in Hebrews 12:6, because the Lord disciplines those he loves and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. So he punishes us, not that we just suffer aimlessly, but he punishes us to discipline us, to shape us. He is the potter. We are the clay. And so lastly, the book of Judges is really a testament to God's faithfulness. Even if we are faithless, God remains faithful. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. And though we may be unfaithful to him, as the Israelites were, he is still faithful to save us and preserve us and to forgive us when we seek forgiveness. And we see Paul write that to the Thessalonican church. We see the Apostle John wrote it to the church in Ephesus, that God is always faithful even when we are not. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8, which is that reference I wrote at the very beginning of the book of Judges. Here it is. He will keep you strong to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, who has called you into fellowship with the Son Jesus Christ, is our Lord and he is faithful. So that is the message of regardless of how faithless we can be, God is always faithful and he is sure to save us just like he did Israel. If we call upon his name. So if you're watching this Bible study and you've never given your heart to Jesus, it doesn't matter what sin you've committed. It doesn't matter what kind of person you think you are. You can always call upon the name of the Lord to be saved. Ask Jesus Christ to save you and he will save you. He will set you free from your sin. Amen. So there is great, great news in the midst of the terrible news in the book of Judges. So I encourage you to read that book as we move next week into the book of Ruth. And also the book of Ruth, we did an in-depth verse-by-verse study of that book as well. So you might want to start going back and looking at those videos. Matter of fact, I think I started the book of Ruth during the beginning of the pandemic back in 2020. So you guys can go back and reference that. So I hope you've learned something tonight. I hope some of the historical information was fun for you. The inventions were fun for you. We'll keep doing those because I just think that's a lot of fun. All right. Well, that's it for tonight. So let's go ahead and dismiss in prayer. And my plan is I will see you on Sunday morning. either live here in the sanctuary, right? Or live on YouTube or Facebook. So Sunday school starts at 10 o'clock. We have Sunday school for all ages. And then morning service starts at 11 o'clock in the sanctuary. I'm going to be finishing my What If Christmas series this coming Sunday on what if Jesus had never been born. So you don't want to miss that. Okay, so check it out. And I'll see you. So let's go ahead and close in prayer tonight. Father God, we thank you so much for your many blessings. And Lord, we just thank you for the honor and privilege we have to gather in your name. And I pray, God, that you be with each one that is watching, each one that will be watching. And I pray, God, that you would watch over us, give us your watch, care, and protection today and in the days ahead. For we pray this in Jesus' precious name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. All right, y'all. Have a great week, and I'll see you Sunday. And I love you, and I'm praying for you. And don't forget to do what your mama told you. Wash your hands. Bye.